This is Duke University.
So my interest is really in control theory and the theory of stability. So as a control engineer, it's my job to get systems to do what we want them to do. So you can think of some sort of robot that you want to complete a task, and the controller is really what transforms your will into reality. Now, we can think of kind of the most straightforward possible approach you could take to do this is maybe to make some sort of mathematical model of how your system behaves and then plan out a sequence of inputs that elicit the response you want. And that's called open loop control. And that pretty much always fails because, as was mentioned earlier today, our models are never, ever perfect. And so it's never going to respond exactly how we thought. So as control engineers, what we do is we take readings of what our system is doing and we feed them back into our controller to give inputs in response to what is actually happening in real time. And that's called closing the loop when we feed that information back to our controller. And now, as a control engineer, my first job is really to try and stabilize the system about the desired operating conditions. So what exactly is stability? Well, the classic example is to compare a ball on the top of a hill versus a ball at the bottom of a valley. So if you can balance a ball perfectly at the top of the hill, if you really place it very carefully. And likewise, you could place a ball at the bottom of a valley and it'll stay still. Both of those points are equilibrium points. So we can imagine that's the state that we want to keep our system at. But the difference is that if you give even the tiniest little nudge to the ball at the top of the hill, it'll roll far away down the hill away from the equilibrium point that you were trying to set. Whereas, if you just give a little tap to the ball at the bottom of the valley, it'll just roll a little bit up the hill and then eventually return back to that equilibrium point. So the ball at the bottom of the hill is stable, whereas the ball at the top is unstable because it can respond, you know, wildly to just a tiny disturbance. And so as a control engineer, my top priority is to get the system behaving as if it's the ball at the bottom of the hill, making it want to return to where we want it to be. Now, one of the big challenges is that sometimes we have to work with systems that are open loop unstable, so their natural tendency is to move away from where we want them to be. So we could encounter these systems sometimes because it's an inherent property of the system. So for instance, in nuclear power plants, there are certain modes of operation that you have to pass through that are open loop unstable. And for instance, the Chernobyl disaster was actually a result of the controllers failing as that nuclear power plant had to pass through an unstable regime. So designing good controllers with guarantees of stability is really crucial. Now, sometimes we also want to work with open loop unstable systems. So for instance, there have been fighter jets designed that are designed to have open loop unstable dynamics because they can actually achieve more aggressive maneuvers. But the trade-off is it's a much more challenging control problem. Now, one of the most important challenges we have to face as control engineers is uncertainty. So we can have uncertainty because of little disturbances, so maybe a gust of wind hitting the ball at the top of the hill, or it could be because we have measurement noise. Nobody can ever measure anything to, you know, infinite precision. Or it could be because we're working with mass-produced systems. So if I'm designing cruise control for a fleet of cars, I don't have time to tweak my controller for every single unit that comes off the assembly line. You have to design a controller that's going to work regardless of all the tiny little differences that will appear because, you know, the lug nuts are tighter on this one than the other one by a small amount. But the most fundamental source of uncertainty that I really think is inherent to almost any system we want to design is that it has to work under variable operating conditions. So we can think about designing, for instance, a firefighting drone. We want to do this because firefighting in, for instance, remote fire, forest fires is a really dangerous and tiring job. And so if I'm designing a firefighting drone, my controller has to work while the drone is flying out towards the fire with a huge payload of water, and it's got to work as the drone is returning home without any water when it's much, much lighter. So my controller has to be robust to a huge amount of variation in the weight of that drone. Now, one thing that we can do to ensure stability despite kind of a huge range of uncertainty is passivity-based control. So a system is passive if it does not create any energy. And we can think of that as a less active system, because if it's not putting any energy into the system, it's going to respond with less energy than you gave it. So it's never going to react wildly like that ball on the hill rolling far away from where you put it initially. And as a result, passive systems are actually guaranteed to be naturally stable. So all we have to do is ensure that our controller is not going to destabilize the system and improve its performance. And we can take advantage of our knowledge that a system is passive to in fact design a controller that will work for every passive system. And there are many systems that can be shown to be naturally passive. For instance, all of the basic circuit elements, robotic arms, spacecraft attitude manipulation, you're working with a passive system, and certain models of human behavior show that the human is actually a passive element in your system. So what this means is that I could design a controller to control a robotic arm, and it will actually be guaranteed to stabilize a spacecraft whose attitude we're trying to adjust. Now, it won't necessarily get good performance, but it won't make things go catastrophically wrong. So that's a huge amount of robustness and an incredibly powerful tool to use. But it's not a magic bullet, because there are many things that can destroy passivity, so it can make the system behave as if it were an active element inputting energy into the system. And one of those things that can destroy passivity is delays. And delays are, first of all, pervasive and of growing importance, because we're trying to implement controllers, you know, in the cloud, and there's inevitably going to be communication delays going on. But also, if we want to have humans in the loop and humans and robots interacting, well, we have a certain finite reaction time, which introduces a delay into our system. And of course, there are also systems like population growth that really have delays inherent to their dynamics. And these delays can really cause problems. So if we think of the example of a human being driving a car following another car, under normal conditions, a human has about a 1 second reaction time, and that's all right. We can respond reasonably to, for instance, the person ahead of us putting on the brakes. But if we're drunk, as the blood alcohol level increases, in fact, our reaction time slows, increasing the delay in our response. And because of that delay, if you look at models of how a human responds to the driver ahead of them, they will actually, that delay can destabilize the response, having them accelerate and decelerate with increasing aggressiveness just in response to the person ahead of them simply braking. Which is why drunk driving is so dangerous. And when we're talking about a human being, you know, we can say, okay, you're not allowed to drive under these conditions. But if we're talking about delays in driving because maybe your sensors aren't giving data as frequently as they should, or maybe there's some sort of delay in your processing, we really need to quantify exactly what kind of delays are our controllers robust to in, for instance, an autonomous vehicle system, and we want to make them robust to whatever delays we might encounter. Another direction that I looked at with passivity-based control is the control of flexible manipulators or robotic arms. So I was initially interested in this because if you look at the space arms, like the Canada arm, that are used to bring payloads to the International Space Station, those are actually really lightweight. And as a result, their arms actually end up being flexible. But they have to carry these really heavy payloads to the station. And so that flexibility becomes a problem. And what in reality we do now is we have those controllers move the payloads really slowly and carefully. And every time there's a maneuver, people have to really carefully plan what's going to happen. But if we can design controllers for these flexible systems that are more robust, then we can execute these maneuvers more quickly and more safely. And increasingly, people are interested in having industrial robots work with humans. And these industrial robots, if they're designed to lift and move heavy machinery, those robots often are heavy, have rigid links. And if a heavy, rigid robot accidentally hits the human being that it's working with, it can seriously injure them. So what people are interested in doing is now designing these big, strong robots, but with either flexible links or flexible joints, so that instead of hitting the person they're working with and breaking the person's arm, instead the robot's arm can just bend. But of course, if you combine these, you know, design objectives with, for instance, controlling those robots over the cloud, and you have these communication delays, or if you're considering the whole system with this human with our delayed reaction time, we have to consider that and really qualify to how are these delays affecting our controllers, and what do we and how do they affect our passivity properties, and how can we react correspondingly. So those are a few design problems that I'm interested in tackling as a control engineer with a focus on stability. So thank you for listening, and if you have any questions, feel free to ask.